Balakrishna, thank you for being our host, co-host. So it is my privilege now to introduce our chief guest and speaker, keynote speaker. I know that Dr. Zaidi prefers to be low-key, but sir, please allow me to introduce you as our chief guest today. Thank you again for being with us today this morning. As Professor Shastri also said, we have been really fortunate of getting the support, active, very proactive support of the Election Commission of India all these years. This is our 12th annual conference, and as General Anil Verma also said, we have made it a point to actually have the conference every year in a different city, typically a capital city of a state, and so far we have not gone to Delhi yet. So Delhi abhi thodi dur hai. Professor Shastri also said, other big fortunate thing that we have had always representation from almost every state of India, every state literally, and the National Election Watch network now is really widespread, and it's an umbrella organization under which we all come together for this cause of furthering the betterment of our democracy and governance in elections. I have a great honor and privilege to introduce our speaker. I'd like to tell you that Dr. Zaidi is from the Indian Administrative Service. He's been in the Election Commission since 2012, and currently the Chief Election Commissioner. I'd like to tell you about a few things about his background. He is actually a doctorate. He's Dr. Zaidi, and he's a doctorate in biochemistry. Just to say what multiple talents and background he has, he also holds a postgraduate diploma in finance. He holds a master's degree in public administration from Harvard University. He was the Director General of Civil Aviation in India, and that was one of his longest tenure, I think almost 12 years, under which India saw this dramatic transformation and revolution, what they call the open skies policies. So he's seen actually the aviation in India go from its nascent stage to now what we have. The Bihar elections, assembly elections which happened recently, were actually the first one under his tenure as Chief Election Commissioner. And sir, we will be releasing the Bihar Election Watch report later under your chief guest. So with that, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker, Dr. Zaidi, Chief Election Commissioner.
So Dr. Ranade, the chairperson of this session, Professor Chokar, Professor Shastri, General Verma, my former Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. Verma, Mr. Gandhi, others, I'm seeing faces, but Mr. Rao, of course, the Joint Director of the Institute, all the invited delegates, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning. This is my first formal interaction with NEW and ADR, and I am very impressed with the simplicity of the function. Generally, we are used to government, we have been used to the government functions, and even some of our even election commission functions, very ostentatious. I really liked it, and I praise the NEW and ADR for this simplicity. This is what is needed. You have saved so many flowers, I am happy. Environment friendly, and I was also welcomed by the joint director by a plant. Very environment friendly. So with these few words, let me at the outset thank NEW and ADR for inviting me to this 12th conference on electoral and political reforms. I am indeed very delighted to participate in this national conference. As mentioned by Professor Shastri, Election Commission has been interacting with ADR for quite some time now on election-related issues, and we have been tremendously benefited as an institution in this ongoing dialogue, directly, indirectly, in improving the purity of elections. And I would like to thank NEW and ADR for these initiatives. I would also like to say that ADR and NEW are dedicated to the cause of promoting electoral reforms and supporting electoral participation. As you know, the current electoral process faces many challenges, such as criminalization of politics, abuse of money, electoral malpractices, amongst others. NEW and ADR have been educating people, build opinions, seek intervention of authorities on these issues, and serve as one of the watchdogs of the electoral democracy in the country. And I would also like to say that ADR, NEW gather data, including from our website, which is not so friendly, I must say, analyze and put it in the public domain. And some of these notable examples include compilation and analysis of information on assets and liabilities, criminal antecedents, veracity of affidavits filed by candidates, variation in expenditure filed by candidates and political parties during election campaign, and which are quite revealing. And I congratulate these organizations for this wonderful work. I must also say that NEW and ADR are our important stakeholders, and being encouraged by these organizations, we have in the Commission developed a framework of collaboration between the Commission and such organizations for work in a non-partisan, non-political manner, and we are very happy about this work. Let me recall at this point in time some of the important developments and contribution made by these organizations and public spirited person in the area of electoral reforms, mostly through judicial interventions to enhance the purity of election in the country. And the current 1.5 decade of this century have witnessed such pronouncements the most, actually. And as mentioned by Professor Shastri, the Election Commission has been very promptly laying down the framework, of course, in compliance of these judicial pronouncement and even otherwise. And this has really improved the situation a lot. Let me first take the decriminalization endeavors in last 10-15 years. It would be little repetitive to many of these pioneers, but I think for the audience it would be necessary to recall them and how it has evolved. I would not go into the details of how the criminalization of politics has taken place and how it affects the governance and quality of lawmaking. I think all of you are very well aware. But before 2002 and 3, voters did not have any information on candidates, particularly about their criminal antecedents, assets and liabilities, educational qualification of candidates. These organizations have undergone through some litigations, and finally the Supreme Court laid down that candidates are required to file affidavits before returning officers, declaring their all information about assets and liabilities, educational qualification and criminal antecedents. We had very promptly laid down a format and manner in which affidavits are to be filed, including now the current option for e-filing. And these affidavits are of course displayed on public notice board in the constituency and website of ECI. ADR and PUCL were the petitioners. This is the contribution. It was noted later on that candidates were not revealing their antecedents and status very truthfully, and they were providing only half truth to the voters. And therefore, to prevent candidates from concealment of information, later on judgments came, and the candidates are required to fill all columns in the affidavits without leaving them blank. The Commission again laid down a framework for issuing notices to candidates in case any column in the affidavit is left blank. The candidature can be rejected by the returning officer if the column is left blank. Here, the Resurgence India, another organization, was the petitioner. Now we are going a step further. The Commission has proposed that if there is any attempt to conceal relevant information, this should be criminalized and there should be a punishment of 2 years for concealing or giving false information in affidavit. Going further in the direction of decriminalization endeavors, the first step which took place in this direction was when the members of parliament and state legislatures started attracting disqualification on conviction for listed offenses and lose their membership forthwith. Forthwith is the most important word, and seats becoming vacant. Earlier, Section 8.4 of the Representation of People Act provided protection to sitting members on such conviction, and this subsection was held ultra vires by the Supreme Court. Again, the Commission, in compliance of the order, forthwith set up a system for prompt reporting of cases of such conviction involving sitting members to speakers and chairmen and to the Commission. And I must say many MPs and MLAs have lost their seats forthwith. Their seats have become vacant forthwith. We are aware that some convicted sitting members have tried to circumvent this process. This process of their seats becoming vacant forthwith against the letdown procedure of the Election Commission of India. They are trying to follow the route of disqualification, getting their applications moved to governors or the Honorable President as the case may be, and in the meantime they are getting stays, getting their convictions reduced and other things. But we are looking at it and we will soon come up with a solution on this aspect. I thought I must mention this before this audience. And again, here the famous petitioner Lily Thomas, later on joined by local Prahari, were the petitioner. The second initiative again came from the Supreme Court. The second step was that all the legislators who are facing criminal cases in the court, their trial must be completed within 1 year. This was to prevent these legislators from dragging on their cases. We don't know how many cases have been decided, but we hope that the cases are receiving priority. And the third important reform which was proposed by the Commission was that a person should incur disqualification on being charge-sheeted, and charge-sheet having been taken cognizance of by the courts in certain defined crimes, heinous crimes involving a sentence more than 5 years. The Law Commission has also now recommended this reform. This is before the Law Ministry now, and this is a very, very major reform proposal and need to be addressed very, very early. But in the meantime, a third step has taken place, and that has come from the Honorable Supreme Court, where the bench has now referred the matter to the Chief Justice for formation of the constitutional bench. Let us hope that matter is also disposed of in a time-bound manner. And actually this third step, when the constitutional issue is decided, would be the real clean-up act for this decriminalization endeavor. The Commission has also been pursuing with government for amendment of law, as you rightly mentioned, to provide for neutral vote provisions for electors who do not find any candidate worthy of their votes. Supreme Court, you know that in PUCL case, ruled that the Commission should provide for nota on EVM and ballot papers so that voters can decide not to vote for any candidate they do not consider fit enough. We again laid down a system and provided nota word in the ballot paper on EVM and also on paper ballot paper. And now, of course, this has been replaced by a proper symbol. As you know, the statistics that election after election, people have been opting for nota. In 2014 election, some 6 million voters opted for this option. And thereafter, in 10 assembly elections in 2014 and 15, some 2.3 million, that means 23 lakh people have cast their votes in favor of nota. The Commission, interestingly, does not publicize this nota either way and leave it to the voters' choice. And in many cases, as you already know, the margin of victory is less than the nota votes. But nota votes not being the deciding factor is not having any impact. Now, the point I was trying to make here was that we feel that transparency of the antecedents of candidates could be one of the contributory factors in people opting for nota. But this would require further study. Maybe some brilliant personality is sitting here. Some IIM professor need to study this, whether nota is the outcome of the transparency as a contributory factor. Now, another aspect pertaining to the criminalization of politics is that criminals and muscle men can contest election while being in jail. In a writ petition in Patna High Court, it was held that a person in jail or lawful custody of police do not have voting right under Section 62(5) of the RP Act and therefore cannot contest. And Supreme Court had upheld this order, but to reverse this process, the Section 62(5) of the RP Act was amended to add a proviso that if a person is in jail or lawful custody, and if his name is enrolled in the electoral roll, he or she will not cease to be elector by reason of his being in jail. And therefore, now being in jail or lawful custody is not a disqualification to contest. We feel this is a backward step and probably needs to be taken up further for reversal of the process. Now, these were the decriminalization endeavors which have come through the initiations of organizations like ADR and many other persons. And as was rightly being mentioned, that things are moving and probably we will see more things to come in future. But in so far as curbing the muscle power, which is deeply connected with the criminalization of politics, the Commission's current framework of use of central police forces and non-central police force measures, targeted actions on identified muscle men, anti-social elements and criminals, protection to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes and weaker section has worked very effectively. And we are reasonably satisfied with the outcome, though we are never complacent. Even events such as physical booth capture is nearly eliminated and a thing of past and can be kept in the museum. We work round the clock on this aspect based on any input from citizens, voters, civil society organization, particularly media campaign round the clock during election period and also on polling day. Actually, the commission's motto is that no voter should be left behind. And somebody mentioned, of course, Dr. Ranade was mentioning about Bihar. Bihar is a classical example of our high bar that has been set in the election management because it was, for the first time, violence-free. Of course, all elections should be violence-free, but Bihar was violence-free, and that is a big achievement, and that is the result of the action of the Election Commission at grassroots level, where we were successfully able to de-muscle the muscle man. And therefore, denial of rights and opportunities to voters by criminals, anti-social elements is deeply connected. And that is why these efforts are taking place in the country and we deeply appreciate. Now, moving on to the another major area of reform relates to election financing. It is a major area, both at the level of the candidate and at the level of political parties. Friends, pernicious effects of money, particularly black money, on purity of electoral process is too well known to narrate here. Regulation of election financing, in our view, should rest on four pillars. One, laying down the expenditure limits of candidates, which is of course there, and also of political parties. Two, disclosure requirements from transparency point of view. Thirdly, its compliance. And fourthly, penalties for non-adherence to this framework. For the sake of brevity, I will not talk about the regulatory framework of candidates and will talk about only the financing of political parties. At the outset, it can be said that political parties under the current legal framework are rather loosely governed insofar as registration, deregistration, and financing is concerned. It is too well known in public domain that elections are expensive due to prevalence of black money, affecting the level playing field and denying equal opportunities to less resourceful parties and well-deserving persons to join electoral politics. Now, the interesting phenomenon is that the money spent by political parties on their candidates make current legal limits on expenditure totally meaningless, particularly in the absence of any limit on political parties on raising resources and also on their spending limit. We also know that, and everybody knows that, the funds are given by political parties to candidates in rather opaque manner, who in any case are under-reporting, as you already know. And our view is, and this we have laid down in our transparency guideline, that the contribution by political parties to candidates should not exceed their statutory expenditure limits. And we have also laid down that the payment by political parties to candidates should be made by check. And you also know that this opaque funding from political parties to candidate flows from 80% of so-called anonymous funds of parties, which are of the amount of less than rupees 20,000 from a single person, which is not prohibited in law. Now here again, a new entity has been set up by the lawmakers. Electoral trusts have also come in existence since 2013, which have become an additional source of funds for political parties. There is no limit on contribution by these trusts to political parties. In 2014 and 15, more than 170 crore rupees were given by these trusts to various political parties. Quid pro quo of vested interest through these trusts and their funding is not ruled out. Trusts are not even governed by the Representation of People Act, and there are no disclosure requirements nor any penalty on these trusts. Interestingly, it was mentioned about foreign sources. There are no restrictions on these trusts on receiving foreign funds. We have taken up, and I learned that Ministry of Law and Ministry of Finance are working together to plug this loophole to bar electoral trusts from receiving foreign funds. Otherwise, foreign funds can be routed to political parties through trusts. And we have received one or two complaints in this regard. So therefore, this amendment is very important. Actually, Section 29B of the Representation of People Act should be amended to prevent trust from making contribution to political parties which they have raised from foreign sources. As far as the disclosure is concerned, you are aware that at present political parties file only one statutory contribution report of the funds received above rupees 20,000 from a single person. There is another report filed by the political parties relating to its expenditure in election, which is filed within 75 days or 90 days of the election, depending upon assembly or parliament. We in the Commission are of the view that political parties should declare all levels of contribution. And therefore, taking cognizance of this aspect, the Commission has, even in the absence of law on political financing and invoking Article 324, has laid down transparency guidelines in 2014 for political parties as well as electoral trusts. Interestingly, both have complied with. After a lot of hesitation, Mr. Brahma knows it, But under protest, they have filed it for the first year in 2014. We have sent it to the Institute of Chartered Accountants for test audit and displayed on ECI website. At least we feel that in the absence of any definite law on transparency, our guidelines have been complied with by electoral trust and by political parties, and at least this is ensuring transparency and the data is being made available in the public domain. As regards expenditure limits, disclosure and penalties on political parties, there are recommendations from the Law Commission which are before the Law Ministry, and we hope that they are processed soon. We have recently received reports from ADR that there was variation in statement of candidates and political parties with regard to funding by political parties to candidates. And you have furnished constituency-wise data on this aspect to the Commission. We are looking into that data. However, taking cognizance of this anomaly, we have in the meantime prescribed that political parties will have to furnish candidates related part expenditure within 30 days, because candidates are required to file within 30 days instead of 75 days or 90 days. This will ensure that there is a correlation between the two statements. And we feel that political parties must openly and transparently report their contribution to candidates to the Election Commission. While being on the political parties, it will be interesting to note that the number has mushroomed from 1,000 in 2009 to now close to 1,900 political parties in the country. If we look at past 5 years, that is since 2011, 753 new political parties have been registered at the rate of one political party every 2.5 days. Every 2.5 days, we have a new political party in the country. And we have studied some international practices where contest in election by parties is a mandatory requirement for registration and continuance of registration. However, the Commission is hamstrung by lack of legal authority to deregister political parties. Now we have prepared a list of political parties of past 10 years who have not contested even a single election. We have compiled reports from the field, and our field reports reveal that most of them are non-existential. We are going to pass appropriate order in such cases. I will not disclose in the public forum, otherwise they will accuse us of being prejudiced. These registered and unrecognized political parties may be conduit for black money. We don't know. However, now under our revised transparency guidelines, we have laid down that all registered unrecognized political parties will have to file their annual audited contribution report to our chief electoral officer. This practice has just begun, and we are going to monitor, and we will see how things come in the future. This would be quite revealing in future, we feel. Again, now I was talking to Professor Shastri when I entered the hall. You are already aware of the current regulatory framework regarding the expenditure monitoring at the field level, which are actually comprising of our expenditure observer and his entire system, comprising of our flying squads and static surveillance team. With our current structure, we are reasonably satisfied in the sense that we are able to prevent the movement of cash, liquor, narcotics, and drugs. And we know that the problem of black money still remains. I have heard people saying that your seizures are very small peanuts and can be bought for the change, and is only a tip of the iceberg. We know it. But as was being mentioned by Professor Shastri, voter awareness is the key. And therefore, we have launched a campaign on ethical voting. We have set up a booth awareness group, which is growing, gaining strength, and yielding positive results. In fact, our awareness observers are going for 6 to 10 days before the election. They review the entire system at the micro level. Actually, the problem lies at the micro level, not at macro level. All informations pertaining to illegal limits must be passed on to the flying squad who are operating at the polling booth level. And now, several mobile and IT initiatives have been started by the Commission, which include installation of GPS on flying squad vehicles to track their movements. We have also started deploying central police forces, because local police force and local officials collude and their flying squads don't go in the right direction. We have also Android software for uploading real-time photos, videos, and complaint of malpractices, real-time coordination by the messaging services. And in this regard, whichever new tool or new application are developed by your state bodies, we will very much welcome. We will continue to strengthen this framework as at grassroots level or ground level, from election to election, to dent the movement of cash, liquor, and gift. As I mentioned, our flying squads are the key points where innovative methods are needed, duly supported by mobile and IT applications, training of manpower, and effective real-time coordination. I would very much like to tell that what we are doing is not enough, and more needs to be done, particularly at grassroots level. And any workable idea that would emerge from this conference will be very much welcome. Another important aspect which needs to be curbed is related to making paid news, and we have already recommended that paid news should be made an offense and should be punishable with imprisonment of 2 years. The present mechanism of detection and confirmation of paid news, though working at the constituency level, is not able to make significant dent, because the candidates are already making cushion for it. We detect, we confirm, we add to their expenditure, but they have already made a cushion and they in any case under report. So there is a need for improvement in this system. We have to take some deterrent action. Some matters are pending before us in our quasi-judicial capacity. So much about the financing and expenditure, where a lot of action is needed on an ongoing basis. Now, the third aspect I would like to talk about is, I hope I have some time left, and this relates to technology, which is very, very significant. Technology have been employed by all election management bodies around the world, and they have brought about accuracy, speed, efficiency, and transparency. I had already mentioned about the problems with our data management. To give a modern outlook, now we have renamed it as Election Data Management Division, and we have acquired some latest software which will make our data on all possible aspects available in formats which can be easily accessed. Our statistical report would be downloadable, and we plan to create polling station level database also. And therefore, I am very glad that the conference is also focusing on this aspect. Any suggestion coming from this conference will assist us in management of our data. Social media, Election Commission has not framed any policy as yet. Of course, the social media's role in the information dissemination and education of users, electors, doesn't need much emphasis. We can spread awareness on ethical and inducement-free voting. Actually, I must say that there is no very defined voter information system. There are efforts being made. We are making efforts. You are making efforts. Others are making efforts, but there is no defined voter information system. And I have liked the idea. Actually, we are also working on the idea that all those voters who have their mobile numbers, we are collecting huge number of mobile numbers. I will tell you in a minute. We want to pass on whether it is information related to awareness, whether it is information related to ethical voting, etc., and finally whether it is related to candidates also. we want to pass it down to the voters through mobile applications. Yes, please do, and I think this is a very significant aspect. The last week only I have discussed with my officials that we need to send this candidate related information directly to the voters. So this is also significant. Only 2 months ago we held a workshop on social media. Now we are framing our approach how much of social media we should utilize. The Commission has been using internet and ICT for convenience of stakeholders. We have about 18 major IT applications from national to district level. Our ECI website receives 400 million hit per annum. Our transaction during election time occupies 35% of the total transactions in the country, which is huge, which is really huge. And but the most important application of our IT, which an area which I think probably organizations like you should also focus and assist us, is the electoral roll management system, because you know electoral rolls, if they are vitiated, unhealthy, defects exist, whether when there are collusive methods to stuff them or to delete them, or where voters have multiple entries, dead voters, then the purity of the election process is really affected. And therefore, this problem is very significant. The problem of multiple entries generally arise due to migration of people and their registration at new place. They don't delete it from their original place. And the sincere efforts to purify electoral roll began last year when Mr. Brahma and I worked together on launching National Voter Service Portal. In March 2015, we launched first National Electoral Roll Purification and Authentication Program using Aadhaar. And I would like to share that before the Honorable Supreme Court order came and the program had to be suspended, we had collected some 33 crores Aadhaar numbers. We had fed some 24 crores Aadhaar number into the system, but then suddenly, and then suddenly the program had to be suspended. And also we collected some 10 crores mobile numbers of voters, and that is where this will come handy to us when we spread candidate related information to the voters. And interestingly, towards the later part of the year, now we have a national database of the entire electorate of the country, which is 85 crores. And again, on 1st March 2016, we have launched National Electoral Roll Purification Program, of course, without Aadhaar. And here what we are doing is that out of our national database, we have identified multiple entries, and I must say these numbers are quite significant. And we have found from our national database that there are multiple entries where a voter is registered at four places. There are entries where voters are registered at two places. So we have identified it from our national database. We have sent it out to the district level. This is the data at the booth level, across booth level, across assembly constituencies, state level and national level. We have a national register of multiple entries. So that kind of work has taken place in past couple of months. We have launched this program, and simultaneously we are collecting names of dead persons from panchayat, name of dead persons from corporations. We are trying to link our national database with birth and death registers systems, IT based system, wherever they are operable. We want to do this one time cleansing of our electoral roll, even at the cost of little adverse publicity in the commission. We want to present a very, very healthy e-roll by September or October, when we will publish our new draft roll. This is one area, if you could kindly help us. And actually, we want to transition to the system where a voter moves to a new place. he or she registers at the new place and his or her name is automatically deleted from the previous place. This is going to be implemented in couple of weeks only. So that is the kind of electoral roll improvement taking place, because that is within our power. We don't have to go to lawmakers, to legislature, to courts, and we are committed to improve it. Now lastly, in all democracies around the world, electoral processes undergo reforms on an ongoing basis, somewhere no progress, somewhere slowly, and somewhere steadily, where systems keep responding to the wishes and expectation of people. And as was rightly being mentioned by Dr. Ranade, that electoral reforms in the final result should produce good representatives for good governance. That is the objective of your organization also. But this brings us an important, this brings up an important issue. Who is responsible for electoral rolls? Who is responsible for electoral reforms to happen? Is it government, legislature, political parties, Election Commission of India, judicial fora, civil societies, or active citizens? Talking about the commission, you know, we joined this journey of electoral reforms in late 90s. And as the initiator of reforms, we have been pursuing our proposals with successive governments. And this journey seemed to have halted since 2010, after that incomplete consultative process of the core committee of the government. We hope that this process will move forward. In December, I had taken up with the law minister, and I was informed by the law minister that the government has constituted a task force to examine all the proposals of the Law Commission and the Election Commission of India, and they are developing a roadmap. We are in constant touch with the Law Ministry. At times, we also hear that Election Commission should invoke Article 324, the fountainhead of its constitutional power. We do invoke it when it is justified. However, our all actions are subjected to judicial scrutiny, and there are limits on exercise of this power under Article 324 laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court. But given this framework, we will continue to play our role as initiator and as an advocate of electoral reforms with legislature, with government, with society at large. I must share with the House that as on date, more than 40 reform proposals are before the Law Ministry, and there.
Sorry, you can mention one issue. National meeting is to be held from
2011. That is what. I said it in another manner that this journey has halted.
Only for one meeting.
I leave it to the audience to understand that this journey has halted since 2010, and 2 months ago, I asked the law minister to at least delink the proposals which are pertaining to rules only, because rule making falls within the competence of the law minister. Law minister was kind enough to reply to my letters immediately, and he asked the commission to submit the notification. We have submitted the notification of these draft rules. Some of these draft rules are very significant, like use of totalizer, amendment of form 24A to disclose the sources of the income, and those fall within the competence of the law ministry. We are awaiting action. I have also held the review with law secretary in the commission. He has also promised to process the matter, and therefore we feel that active response to election commission's reform proposal on electoral reform is the need of the hour. Active citizens have been knocking at the door of courts, getting pronouncement. Commission has been very, very promptly implementing these judicial pronouncements. But I must say, this is not a wholesome process, because changes come around in piecemeal manner. There is a need for far more effective institutional structure to pursue electoral reforms. Time and again, I must say that legal reforms involving Constitution, Representation of People Act, do require multi-party approach, because without multi-party approach, reform process cannot move. Therefore, a standing body of lawmakers of all parties can sit together and can take a view on these electoral reforms and must decide finally this way or that way. But given whenever that comes up in future, we feel that our electoral reform proposal must attain finality soon rather than later. And political parties need to come forward. They need to be as much active. Individual legislators come and they talk to us and they seem to be in favor. But somehow there is no critical mass of legislators who can, within the political parties, push their political parties to push these reforms. And therefore, the commission is very happy. I am very happy to be participating in this meeting. You have brought all stakeholders together. All of us will have to work together to carry on this journey. We hope that whether it is happening incrementally or there is sometimes a major wave that may come, because we are always hopeful of reform proposal moving forward in the future. We will work together, and from the Election Commission of India side, we can assure you that we will always be working with right thinking people in a non-political, non-partisan manner. And at the end, I would like to wish this conference a great success. I'm sorry I have taken a little longer, but I thought it was worth sharing with the audience. Thank you very much.
Join me in thanking him for a very, very comprehensive talk and interactive session. We now have Dr. Zaidi. We will now have the release of the Bihar Election Watch report. May I request Professor Shastri, Mr. KJ Rao, Rakesh, and Rajiv from Bihar Election Watch, please to come to the stage.